Hello. So I am lucky enough to get to make programs about space, and it's cool because I've always seen space and science as part of popular culture and something that can be part of our entertainment culture as well as something that we take very seriously and work in. And I was thinking about this when I was asked to do this talk. I was thinking about imagination and the power of the imagination, and that's what I wanted to talk about, why it's easier for us to imagine some things rather than others. And I thought I would start with this guy. Who said very famously, imagination is more important than knowledge, for knowledge is limited, whereas imagination embraces the whole world. And I don't want to get off on the wrong foot by disagreeing with Einstein. But nevertheless, I do think when you look back at the history of space exploration, when you look at the history of humankind, you do realize that frequently, while there are wonderful triumphs, amazing feats of imagination that have taken us to places we could never have dreamed of otherwise, there are also some quite spectacular failures of imagination. There are some blind spots that we have in our imagination. There are things that seem to be more difficult for us to imagine than others. For instance, I will start with an example from my own life. One of the things that I got very, very intrigued by and that really, really interested me in space was collecting space stamps when I was a child. I actually still do it today. Does anyone else want to admit to that particularly cool, sexy hobby? No, I genuinely do it. It's not just something I say to try and get a date. But one of my favorites, well, I loved the space stamps that depicted Laika. Many stamps. It was wonderful. Obviously, we all recognize Laika. We all know what happened to her, of course. She went to live in a farm in space. That's what happened. Don't want to hear anything else. But far fewer people, this is what always amazes me, far fewer people. Everyone knows the story of Laika. Far fewer people know the story of Felix, the first ever cat in space. I only discovered Felix because of my space stamp collection. One day, I got a beautiful, beautiful set of stamps from the Republic de Niger, celebrating the achievements of our four-legged friends in space. I loved these stamps instantly. I was also really, really immediately began to wonder. I began to wonder about the reaction in the post offices of the Republic de Niger when they went in to buy a stamp and were greeted by this particularly fine specimen celebrating, as I say, Felix, first cat in space. Sort of less of a stamp, more of a terrifying B-movie poster, I think. Felix does appear to be controlling that rocket by the power of his evil feline mind. Does anyone know which country, it's not difficult, which country put Felix in space? France, because that's what they're like. 1963 was the first cat in space, a year we will come back to. I did wonder, actually. I thought maybe this is a one-off. Maybe this is an unusual portrayal of what is undoubtedly a remarkable cat. Very much not, no. You do start to see a theme if you collect images of Felix, is all I'll say. Someone did actually say to me, is that a little hat he's wearing? Is that a little hat they've given to French space cat Felix? I'd have to say, so unfortunately, no. It's a box of electrodes feeding information directly back to Paris, as I say, the French. So this made me think, why do we all know about the dogs in space and not the cats in space? That was my sort of starting point. And I still wonder as well, why, if you say to most regular people, if you ask most regular people to imagine a group of astronauts, they'll probably picture something like this. They'll probably still picture, even though this was many, many years ago, the Mercury 7 astronauts. I do love this picture, I should say, for many, many reasons. Not least because they ran out of silver space boots just before the photo call. So you can see the guys at the front. They go, quick, just paint them. No one will notice. Be fine. I do love this photograph. These are all these men. These men are incredibly heroic, wonderful astronauts. But they are all. It's an interesting group because all of the group are men. All of the group are white. All of the group are sort of fairly, you know, they're fairly sort of American, all American heroes. They're all from a military background, and that's just, I think, sometimes what we expect when we think about astronauts, but I don't think it necessarily has to be that way. For instance, America did not have, we'll come on to this in a second, America did not have an official women in space program. They did not put a woman in space until 1983, but that wasn't for want of trying by some other women who I'll talk about in a minute. Now, Americans, I think, at the time really debated whether or not space was a place for women. Obviously, today we wouldn't have that question at all, but I think the question, if it needed to be answered, was answered very succinctly in 1963 by this woman, Valentina Tereshkova, first ever woman in space. On her one and only space mission, she orbited the Earth for 2 days, 23 hours, and 12 minutes. That was more time she amassed in space than all these guys at that point put together. Khrushchev, the Russian premier, said at the time, here is your weaker sex. So she was kind of extraordinary. But I always wondered, what happened with the Americans? Why didn't the Americans also have, they were competing with the Russians in every way, so why didn't the Americans also put women in space? Well, I think partly it was to do with the culture that pervaded certain aspects of NASA at that time. Possibly, to some extent, this guy, I'm guessing you recognize him. Wernher von Braun, yes, Wernher von Braun pictured here in his office in NASA during the infamous glue on the desk episode. Some heads rolled after that, let me tell you. So he was a complex man, I think we can say. I'm trying to be diplomatic here. He was a complex man, von Braun. He was asked in a press conference, he was asked that there was a rumor going around that the Russians were going to put a woman in space. Journalists said to him, what about you? What about you? What about us Americans? Are we going to put women in space? And he jokingly replied, he said, oh, I've asked my colleagues, you know, we discussed it with the astronauts, they're all for it. On our next mission, we're reserving £110 for recreational equipment. Yes. I don't know about you, slightly puts me off, ex-SS officer and Nazi, Wernher von Braun. Anyway, we'll move on. Sorry. But yeah, it was a very different culture, very, very different culture in NASA in those days. For instance, NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory employed its first female engineer in 1961, Dana Utley. She was working on extra, you know, vehicles that were going to go beyond Earth's atmosphere. She began working on that. But in the 1960s, there was a beauty pageant held at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory for the female staff members. Now, I'm sure you'll know the Jet Propulsion Laboratory still builds vehicles for NASA today. It was also involved in military equipment, as well as space equipment. I've got a picture of the beauty pageant happening. You will possibly not believe me, but I'm not making this up. The woman there is being crowned Miss Guided Missile. Different day, different age. But not everybody, even in those days, even in the 1960s, not everybody at NASA thought like that. Some people had more vision than this. The person particularly who was challenging this definition of women as you know, no good for spaceflight was the guy charged by NASA with determining the health of astronauts, selecting astronauts, looking at what were the requirements in terms of health and physicality for astronauts. He has a wonderful, only in America name. His name is Dr. Randy Lovelace II. In my imagination, he looks like this. Sadly, in reality, he looked like that. Dreams. But he's an extraordinary guy, okay? He's an absolute maverick and he is a visionary. During the war, there's a problem with pilots bailing out of aircraft at high altitude. He tries to solve that problem by doing experiments himself, which involve him bailing out of an airplane at 40,000 feet. He's also one of the people who invents the first oxygen masks. Cabins were not usually pressurized in airplanes in those days. Really, really extraordinary visionary guy. And he realizes that women could be the answer to America's problems. Women could be the people who help America catch up with Russia, as they were behind Russia, of course, in the space race in the early 1960s. They could be the women, they could be the people who help America to win. Because he spotted something. He realizes that women generally weigh less than men, so they're a lighter cargo. They breathe less oxygen. Also, they produce less waste. I've always thought that would be the worst criteria to fail on, wouldn't it? You were doing so well in the tests, and then where did all that come from? Anyway. So he realizes women could have a crucial role to play, and without entirely getting his bosses at NASA on board, he begins to test elite female pilots from all across the US to see how they compare to the male astronauts who've already been male astronaut candidates who've already been selected from the military. 13 women passed the initial battery of tests. All these women hold land speed records. They're all extraordinary pilots. They're all very, very gifted. So three of those women he begins to take to the next stage of testing. interesting, and one in particular really, really starts to stand out. Her name is Jerry Cobb. She learns to fly when she's a 12-year-old girl. By the time she's 21 years old, she has a job delivering bombers and military aircraft to foreign air forces. I've got a picture of her here at NASA. It's a bit unfortunate the way I've cropped that picture, because it does look a little bit like she's vacuuming that space capsule. That would very much undermine my message. That's not what's going on, just so we're all clear on that. But Jerry Cobb, she's an extraordinarily gifted pilot, and she genuinely starts to believe, she really starts to hope that she will be America's first woman in space. But it's not to be. The powers that be at NASA very quickly want to nix this idea of female astronauts from America. They don't want to hear about that. They Lovelace asks for more funding to do more research. He says, I need more funding to research the difference between male and female astronauts. The reply comes back, do you not already know? They don't take him entirely seriously. But the women who are involved in his program are very well connected. One of them is married to a senator. So these women, these Mercury 13 women, as they've come to be known later, take their fight all the way to a congressional hearing on astronaut selection. But they're fighting against the tide. It's really unfortunate. It's just the beginning of the 1960s, just a couple of years before the Equal Pay Act and Equality Act will start to bring a breath of fresh air, a breath of equality into American life. And they don't succeed. And their story is gradually forgotten. They get a lot of publicity at the time in the 60s, but they gradually fade from public view, and people forget altogether that America once considered sending women into space, and they don't really reappear publicly until the 1990s. There's a picture of them there as older ladies when they've gone to watch Eileen Collins, who was of course the first woman to pilot the space shuttle and also the first woman to command it, and they're there showing up to give her support for her launch, basically. They wrote to her beforehand. They said to her, thank you for doing this, because we feel now that we have a future. And she wrote back and said to them, thank you for coming along, because now I feel like I have a past, which is kind of lovely. But these women weren't the only people who were excluded from the American space program. Kennedy began with a very idealistic, wonderful vision of people cooperating, people from all over the world working together and cooperating in space. He personally selected an African-American man to be one of the first astronaut candidates, this guy, who's Ed Dwight, and he was kind of an extraordinary pilot. He really wanted to go into space, but after Kennedy was assassinated, he said he felt he was pushed out by the space establishment. He never got to fly, and today, actually, he has a very successful career as a sculptor, so he actually moved over to the art, so he didn't let that stop him. So it's here's another story, and I do feel that this is the arts. It's when we look to the arts, we can sort of, changing tack a little bit, when we look to the arts, that's where some of the stories, some of our ideas about who should go into space, who shouldn't go into space, how we imagine our future in space comes from. For instance, I'm a big fan of science fiction movies, I guess. Probably a lot of you are as well. I always wonder about the stories that are chosen, to be made in films. I look at the upcoming films, and they're all about superheroes. And I think an author I would like to recommend to you, actually, if it's not a bit weird to recommend a science fiction author, one of my favourite science fiction authors ever is Octavia Butler. And I'm still waiting. I always look to see, when are we going to have a big budget adaptation of one of her books? If you are interested in finding out about her, a really good place to start is by reading Bloodchild or indeed Kindred. Those are my two recommendations. It's not weird to give a book recommendation. Anyway, I'm very, I always think there are so many stories that we haven't heard. There are so many stories, even from the 1960s, that we still haven't heard. For instance, we all know about the wonderful heroism and cool-mindedness and nerves of steel that Neil Armstrong showed when he landed on the moon and all the alarms were going off and the fuel was running out and it was terrifying. But what far fewer people know is that the code that the lunar lander was using was written by a young MIT engineer called Margaret Hamilton, and it was her code working alongside Neil Armstrong's bravery and nerves of steel that really made the moon landing happen and happen as a success. So I want to know that story. Another story I really want to know, I only found out about this recently. In the 1950s and 60s in Langley, Virginia in the US, there were a group of female mathematicians, African-American mathematicians, who were working on calculating trajectories for the Apollo missions. They were living in a racially segregated society and calculating where spacecraft were going to travel beyond Earth's atmosphere. That's just a wonderful story, I think. It's not just a story I want to hear for sort of diversity reasons or box-ticking reasons. I think that's just a great story. It just has the feel of a great story about it. So I was very pleased to see that is going to be a film. Oprah Winfrey is on the case with that one. Yes. So I'm kind of really pleased about that. And that's the thing, because we don't hear about these women who were involved in making the calculations for the Apollo missions. We don't hear about them. When people talk about the computing power that was behind the Apollo missions, they don't think about the human beings. They don't think about the women, quite often, who were doing that. It's always the same story that's trotted out about, oh, there's more computational power in your mobile phone that you have in your hand than that took us to the moon. And we always hear that. We don't hear about the women. And I did think, actually, just to segue slightly there, that about the Rosetta mission, because that started 2004, am I right? I'm sure someone will correct me very quickly if I'm not. Yes, thank you. 2004, the Rosetta mission, and I started thinking about what phones were like back in 2004, and then I saw the video for Adele's Hello, and I realised that may be the message that she is sending us with that flip phone from 2004. Anyway, I will move on. Times have changed very much. Things are very, very different in NASA. The most recent NASA astronaut cohort, 2013, equal numbers of men and women. That's a really exciting advance. Also, relatively recently, we passed a significant milestone. I can share this with you now. I've got a graph. The number of women in space finally exceeded the number of dogs in space, ladies and gentlemen. Now, I have quite a whimsical imagination, as I will say, but I don't believe that those dogs wanted to go into space more than those women did. I want to end very, very quickly by saying yes, that we must. Imagination is a tremendously important thing, but we must always try to follow Einstein's idea of imagination that embraces the whole world, an imagination that takes everybody with us. Whose voices aren't we hearing? Whose voices aren't carrying, even here on Earth, let alone in space? So I'm going to close with the words of one of my heroes, one of my favourite astronauts. I do have a sort of top 10. This is American astronaut. She's dancer, physician, Peace Corps officer, and also the first African-American woman in space, Dr. Mae Jemison, who said, "Never be limited by other people's limited imaginations." I'm going to end with that. Thank you very much.